We're going to go to Luke, the 19th chapter. And I'm going to begin reading at the first verse. It says, "And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans. And he was rich." The third verse said that he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press because he was little in of stature. And just looking at this on this morning, and I'm just going to read and talk about this morning. Zacchaeus is a very familiar story with us. Story, I can remember this story and just read through this story. It brings out some more points of who we are and how we are to persistently look and seek after God. Zacchaeus just wanted to see who Jesus was, and it could not because of his stature and his size. Could not get to a place the way he could see Jesus because of the crowd. As I was studying this, the text let us know that it was suggested that Zacchaeus might have heard about the blind man that was just healed on the outside of Jericho. And the Bible talks about it in the same chapter. The chapter before talks about the certain blind man that was on the road of Jericho to Jericho, outside of Jericho, that was blind, and he needed to, he heard about Jesus passing through. And hearing about Jesus passing through, the blind man heard the crowd as they was passing by, and he asked the crowd, "What is the meaning of this?" The question was, what did this mean? Other words, why is the crowd reacting the way that they were acting? And you know the story that they told him that Jesus was passing by, and the blind man began to cry out, saying, "Jesus, thy son of David, have mercy upon me." You know, as he was crying out, and as the story goes on to tell us, and the lesson goes on to tell us that the blind man was told and rebuked and told to be quiet. Hold his peace. Don't say a word. Don't just hold your peace. Be quiet. Just shut up and don't bother him. But the blind man refused to hear what the crowd was saying, and the blind man continued on to cry out to Jesus. They called him David, the son of David, have mercy upon me. He cried out the more to finally he got Jesus' attention, and as he got Jesus' attention, then Jesus told him to bring the blind man to me. And then as they brought the blind man to Jesus, Jesus then began to ask the blind man a question of, "What is it that thou would have me to do for thee?" And the blind man said, "That I may receive my sight." Jesus went on to tell the blind man at that point that his faith have saved him. That his faith have saved him. And so Zacchaeus, having hearing this story, having hearing about it, because it just happened right outside the road of Jericho. He was while Jesus was on his way. Now Jesus is now entering into Jericho, and Zacchaeus finds himself in the same situation. Now he just wanted to see this man and see who it was that healed the blind man on the side of the road, that the miracle was taking place there on the side of the road, to the point to where he just wanted to lay eyes on him. The Bible, the text lets us know that he sought, he desired to see Jesus. He desired to see Jesus. And I want you to know, in this day and time, we still need to have that same desire, that same concept, that we want to see Jesus, and no matter what part of our life, we want to see him. We want to see who he really is, to know who he really is, and to see him for ourselves. It's one thing to hear the story of somebody else's story about how Jesus worked in their lives, but I want to see Jesus continue to work in my life. as well, because good, it's good that we can overcome by other people's testimony. And don't get me wrong, I'm not fighting against the scripture, because the scripture says that we overcome by the words of our testimony. But what I want to do is that in this day and time is we got to look and see Jesus for ourselves. Look and try him for ourselves. If we go on and read this story, Zacchaeus now is trying to see who he is and want to see who he is and lay eyes on him, and his desire caused him to want to, and as he tried to, he goes and find himself at the opposition that's set before him. Being the man that he was, he can't get through the crowd. He couldn't see over the crowd to reach his objective of seeing who Jesus is. So what he did was, and you know the story, he ran ahead of the crowd and ran ahead of the opposition that was set before him. He ran ahead of it to the point where now he's determined, as I heard earlier, he's determined to get to the point to where his obstacles is not holding him back from entering into what he is knowing to, that is going to be, not knowing at the time, that really eventually caused him to the point of receiving salvation. He just knowing that he wanted to see who he was, and he did not let the distraction or the crowd prevent him from getting to that point. We as individuals that has already been discussed so very well this morning, we cannot let little things in life cause us to the point to where we miss our opportunity of getting to really know who Jesus is. We can't let things get ahead of us just because the crowd is saying one thing and we listen to the crowd just because we get in that zone of talking to ourselves, and our mindset is set on the wrong thing to the point to where we let our mind trick us out of getting to the point to where we really go to seeing Jesus for who he is. If you now, you know, Zach here hearing all this, and he gets ahead of the crowd. So in the fifth verse, let me go back to that fourth verse. I got to read the fourth verse. And the fourth verse said, and he ran before and climbed into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. So when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste, come down, for today I must abide at thy house. Now look at this. Now Zacchaeus, now the one that's running ahead of the crowd, did not allow the opposition of the crowd to keep him away from what his goal was. It's just simply, as the text says in the earlier verse, is just to see Jesus. He didn't say that he was trying to get and beg Jesus to come and sit with him or to abide with him. His obstacle was, an objective was, just to see Jesus. But now this Jesus now is now looking at him now. Now the one that wanted to see, now God is taking a time out now, and the situation is reversed. Now the man that he wanted to see now is taking a toll and now looking for him now, looking at him and causing him, not only causing him, but calling him by name. Zacchaeus, come down. Make haste. Come down. For today I must abide at thy house. Jesus now knowing, now revealing that he must spend some time with Zacchaeus. Now everybody else, if you go to know the story, everybody else in this crowd now looking at Jesus is wondering why Jesus is spending time with this sinner. Why is Jesus spending time with this tax collector? Why is Jesus spending time with someone that the crowd is thinking that was not deserving of Jesus' time? But if you look at it in the last chapter, Jesus still is spending time with the one that the crowd is saying, that the people are saying, that Jesus shouldn't have time. If you remember, he told the blind man, the crowd told the blind man to be quiet. Rebuked him. Hold your peace. Stop it. People will always be and have an opposition for you not to spend that time with Jesus. And when Jesus was spending that time with those individuals, the crowd did not believe that Jesus should have took time out for them. But then in the situation, as the text let us know, Jesus said, I must. It was no maybe, it was no possibility, it wasn't nothing that Zacchaeus said, but Jesus told Zacchaeus, I must abide at thy house. And after Zacchaeus has made the effort to go ahead of the crowd, he knew that Jesus had to pass that way. He knew that the only way to see him was to climb up in that sycamore tree. He knew. And now Jesus is coming by, stops and look up at him and call him by name. A man that he had never met, a man that he had never seen, a man that he had fought so hard to see who he was, now is calling him by his name. The one that did not look at his stature. And then Jesus, let me back that up, let me break it down just a little bit, because Jesus didn't look at his stature. His stature was what trying to prevent him from getting to Jesus. But when Jesus finally saw him, Jesus didn't see his stature. Jesus didn't see his status. Jesus didn't see what the crowd see. All Jesus seen was an individual that he must go and abide with. And as the lesson goes on to say, now Jesus called this sinner by name. He said, I remember this song that Tasha, I think it's Tasha Cobb, say that he knows my name. That he knows my name. You see, God knowing all of our name. God is calling all of us by name. God is calling each and every one of us, regardless of our stature, regardless of our status, regardless of any physical limitation that is causing in our life. God is seeing past those limitations and calling us each and every one by name. Now the problem is, how is we responding to the call of God? How is we responding to the word that when he calls you by your name, when he calls Alexander Dwayne Wright, why would he calls you by your name? How are we responding to the call of God? Zacchaeus' response was he made haste and came down. But see, when God calls some of us, sometimes we be a little lax. We won't move as Zacchaeus did. We won't get enough hurry. We won't move for God. We won't do those things that God is required for, because we go to calling us, we make up every excuse not to be obedient to the call that God has made. I can see Zacchaeus saying, why is he calling? How do he know my name? Who told him my name? I don't know this man. Why should I go down? I can see every excuse is rising up in this conversation that Jesus is having when he called his name. Just like we have excuses all the time why we can't do what God is calling for us to do. While we have excuses all the time to say why we can't do what that God is requiring of us to do. And as that song keep on going through my head, he knows my name. He knows our situation. He knows all about us. He knows us before we ever got to the point to where we're having an encounter with him. All thing he was doing was putting things in place so when we did have the encounter, it's up to us now to hear the call of the Lord. And as we go on to read, Jesus looking at him and who he was, Jesus not seeing the past, just his effort to get to him. Jesus knowing his name, called him by his name. In the sixth verse, and he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. Look at that. He made haste, came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, talking about when they, the crowd, when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was going to be a guest with a man that is a sinner. Now listen to what the crowd said. Now people a lot of times will miss out on what their true blessings, because if they go to listen to the crowd, go to listen to the individual that's whispering in their ear, they will never get to what God has for them or get to what God got for them, because they listening to the crowd. The crowd is always going to be making some kind of noise. The crowd is always going to be making some kind of excuse. Why is Jesus going to deal with this sinner man? But the Bible says in that sixth verse that Zacchaeus had received him joyfully. Joyfully. He had received the man that when he said, I'm going to abide with you now. He received that joyfully. As he received it joyfully, he was happy that Jesus was coming to live with. And so many times, church folks of this day, they happily receive Jesus, but what happens is they go listen to the crowd, and the crowd make them think that what they have heard from Jesus. What they, that joy that they have heard before now is not really worth it. So I'm so glad as our kids gave us a good example of what to do when the crowd is talking. Zacchaeus went over here joyfully, went to the house, and the Bible never explains what the conversation was between Zacchaeus and Jesus, but at the very next verse says that Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man false, by false accusation, I'll restore him fourfold." See, now all we know is between the 7th verse and the 8th verse that Zacchaeus has had a change of heart, because in the 2nd verse, Zacchaeus was a chief publican. He was a chief tax collector. He was a rich man. The Bible describes him as a rich man. And it was common in that day that when they tax collector did, they made their wealth off of putting extra charges on the people. But Zacchaeus said, now that there's been a change in his life, now that he's a new creature, now he has met Jesus, now he has changed his output on life. Now he said, if I took anything from anybody, if I did anything falsely, and that's the problem. We got to be sure in each and every individual, because the only person knew if they had did anything wrong was Zacchaeus himself and Jesus. And in your life, the only person that really knows what you have done wrong is you and the Lord. And if you know you had done wrong, and I didn't know this morning going to go like it was going, I promise you I didn't. But if you know that the command is one thing, and you know you're doing it going against the command, everyone has to acknowledge what they have done wrong. Everyone has to acknowledge that there has to be a change after true repentance have taken place. And the only way you're going to know if there's been a change is look at the behavior and the actions after they come back and say to Jesus and say, "Lord, I'm sorry, I have messed up." Look at their action afterward. If their action continues to be the same way it was before, then you know there was a change. The fruit have not changed. The criticism has not changed. And Zacchaeus now is showing that there have been a change in his life. So somewhere between the 7th and the 8th verse, there was a repentance situation going on. And somewhere in between that 7th and 8th verse, Zacchaeus has changed his outlook on life. And the Bible goes on to say in the 9th verse, and I almost finished here, in the 9th verse, it says that, "And Jesus said unto him, this day salvation comes to this house, for so much as he also is a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man cometh to seek and to save that which was lost." Now Jesus is saying, and this is the subject of my lesson for today, another one of those this day's moment. Because if you remember the last sermon I preached, Jesus also told another sinner that had a decent conversation, a real conversation with him on the cross, that "This day thou shalt be remembered with me in paradise." Now the story has changed, and that same conversation now is being had between Zacchaeus and the Lord. And the Lord tells him, "This day salvation has come to this house." In other words, because Zacchaeus approached him the way he did, because Zacchaeus went to him and had the conversation that he had with him the way that he did, now Jesus is telling him now that salvation is yours. And so what I'm trying to tell you, another this day moment is this could be your day. When Jesus is having a conversation with you, where he's calling you by your name, where he's calling each one of us by our name and trying to have a conversation with us, this is our day to take advantage of this day moment. If you can hear what I'm saying, if you get what I'm saying, this could be our this day. This could be our this moment. This could be if we've already had a past this day, but this could be another day, this day, that we can renew what we had in the past, because we don't know where we might have come up wrong, and we don't know where we might have done wrong. But if we know it, this could be another day that we can live in repentance, another day that we can say, "Lord, just make it right with me, because I want to be ready when you come back." Lord, I want to be ready when you get ready to part the skies, because this day has been a day that I can take advantage of. And this day, Zacchaeus did not let his physical limitations stop him. Zacchaeus did not let his stature keep him closed off and missing his opportunity of salvation. Zacchaeus beat the crowd and did what it took to get in his eyesight of Jesus, to the point where Jesus could have a conversation with him and abide in his house. So don't let people stop you from getting to Jesus. Don't let people cause you to miss out on your opportunity to get to the man that is able to do anything except fail. And now he's sitting up on the side of the Father, making intercession for each and every one of us that's boldly coming before him and saying, Lord, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I want to be yours. I want to be more like you. And you're calling me by my name. And I hear you calling, Lord. Here am I. This day I will do whatever it takes to get my salvation. So, church, I'm praying that each one of us will search our lives and make this day our very best day, because it could be.